So, Chavi, I think you are on mute as well. So, if you can just unmute yourself. So far, I think what we have done is, if a quick recap in terms of where we started and where we are right now in this journey. I think we started with understanding the different phases of a large-scale transformation. Hi, Nitin. And we went detail into the entire awareness of the first phase, initiate phase. Then we looked at how do you mobilize as the second part of the process. Then today we will talk about how do you scale this entire transformation initiative. So before we kind of go there, anyone would like to quickly share what you remember from the last session that we had? Anything that comes to mind, so maybe we can maybe go around the table. So last time we started with Rajesh, so this time let's start with Nitin.
Okay, it's about if we are planning for a change, there would be a resistance. So there should be a motivation to change or a discomfort to be created with a vision where we want to move to. And it's about taking a very first step.
Yeah. Okay.
And usually we'll see a change maker sits in the middle layer. They won't be on the top, they won't be on the ground root level where they're working because it's easy for any organization or system which is looking for a change if people sitting on that layer is doing it because they have a perspective of both the places.
Actually, contrary to that, I think this needs a little bit of understanding a little more deeper. It's not that change efforts are more successful when led by people in the middle. It is just the fact that, practically speaking, a lot of times people in the middle are the ones who are expected to drive those changes. Fundamentally speaking, any change that is driven both from top down and bottom up together is when changes, those transformation efforts are successful. If it is just top down, it doesn't work. If it is just bottom up, it doesn't work. So it has to be a combination of top down and bottom up. Unfortunately or fortunately, people who actually end up leading some of these change efforts as part of the change management office or the transformation office are typically sitting in the middle. And they get squeezed both by the top management as well as by the grassroots level. So they have to manage both up and down. And that is where the ability for the change agents or people like you and me who are expected to drive the transformation, it becomes extremely important that we, number one, understand the landscape, understand who the key influencers are, whether it is, whom should you update, whom should you seek feedback from, and whom should you include in your steering committee, all of that, and who should be your, who will spread the change within the organization becomes very critical. And also the fact that what we're going to talk about today is also very critical because you need to understand those functionalities as well, because you are at the middle, but neither at the top nor at the bottom. Right? So that's probably the only reframing that I would do from what you just said. But you're right. I mean, typically, change leaders are sitting in the middle, which makes their job that much more difficult. And which means that, you need to understand the ability, and you need to understand how do you influence people over and above whatever needs to be done without actually having authority over those people that you're trying to change. Right? So that's influence without authority kind of comes in, which we will talk about today. Thanks. Thanks, Nitin. So, Hemant, would you like to share what you remember from the last session?
Yeah, I think there were about three main takeaways for me, Mukesh. One was, I think, whatever Nitin mentioned, right? I think the dissatisfaction, the vision of the future state, and yeah, I think clearly defining the first steps, I think that should be greater than the possible resistance
Yeah.
being put by the people. So that was one thing. The second thing, which is very important for me personally, is that momentum, right? How do we build that momentum, and why is it important for for the change or the transition to or the transformation to happen successfully? And you also talked about that full spectrum communication, right? Where you have to have all the three, the ethos, pathos and the logic or the data, the logic and the emotion to be a part, so that it addresses the different set of audience who will be looking at. And then I think that BJ Fox logic that you shared, behavior is equal to motivation into ability to execute and the time it takes.
No, it's not the time, it's a trigger.
It's a trigger to. So I think that was another major takeaway for me. But I was actually struggling with, in my current project and product, building that momentum, right? So now, since I was defining the OKR for the next year for my product, now I'm able to transition that into my sprints and then taking it to like quarterly reviews and all those things. So, but that was a key learning for me.
Cool. Thank you so much. Priya, would you like to share what you remember from the last session? You are on mute, so you might have to unmute yourself. Okay, so we'll come back to Priya. So Chavi, would you like to share what you remember from the last session?
Yeah, I mean, for me, it was more about how things, should be conveyed to the, people who are into power, rather than, all of us know at times that we need to address certain issues. And we do go and, try and convince people sitting at higher authorities, the higher authorities, immediate concerned people. But then how it is being taken by them is a different, perspective. So rather than what is being said, how it is being said is to be taken care of.
Yeah. So that's where the full spectrum communication comes into play. And we will talk a little bit about storytelling and a little bit of about influence today. So that's nice. So anything else that you remember?
That was more of it.
Thanks. Thanks, Chavi. Maybe Rajesh, would you like to go next? What do you remember from the last session?
I'm kind of, I have been always thinking about this formula, B is equal to MAT. I think it's such a powerful thing that because it's so simple, it becomes even more difficult and, it becomes even more challenging to keep it simple and implement it, So that I'm still trying to digest that and, trying to see how it can be applied across all the variety of things that that I'm part of, so that definitely is quite a profound concept for me, which I was totally not aware of, and I'm still digesting, as I said. There was one more key thing, I think, taking the stakeholders as a buy-in of the change versus making them as investors to invest in. That shift in attitude would make a lot of difference with respect to their involvement in the change itself, right?
Yeah.
So, I think these two are pretty.
That's a big shift. That's a big shift because the entire attitude that people have towards the change effort shifts. And instead of, what's in it for me, they start thinking about, how can I make this successful? And that shift is actually the key between having a successful transformation versus having a transformation which struggles.
So I have a follow-up question on this aspect, because I think that this is a very key thing in terms of implementing changes, because if we have all these stakeholders as turned into investors versus the buyers, it would become easier relatively, right?
Yeah.
But then it is not always the case where you start the change right from the beginning point and then you are involved in the starting point, and then you have the opportunity to convert each and every one of the stakeholder into an investor. Sometimes it happens that they join in between, people change, processes change. So I think if you could connect this with the today's topic about influencing without authority, and try to see how try to shed more light around this aspect today, that'll be great.
Sure, we'll come to that. I think one of the key shifts when it comes to leading transformation and successfully leading transformation stems from the fact that right at the beginning, you need to know who are the stakeholders who will get impacted. If you remember the Venn diagram that we had, as to know the influential leaders, the influential connectors, and the impacted. So, and that Venn diagram to be done right at the start, and getting those three set of constituents, or the four set of constituents, which is, you know, whom should you continuously update, whom should you seek feedback from, and who should be your change agents, and who should be part of your steering committee. So that's super critical. If you get that one step right, subsequent steps become that much more easier. But we will, when we talk about influence and when we talk about principles of influence, we will talk about this as well. And so Priya, can you still hear us? If you can unmute yourself and share what you remember from the last session. You're still on mute. Okay, so looks like, yes, Priya. Priya, we can hear you. You went again on mute. Okay, so no problem. Let's start with today's session. So let me know if you're able to see my screen. Can you see my screen?
It's loading.
Now, can you see my screen?
Yeah, it's visible now.
Okay, cool. So we spoke about the first two phases in the first two sessions, which is the initiate phase and the mobilize phase. Once you have enough momentum going is when you need to start scaling the change. When I say scaling, I mean really getting the larger ecosystem of people involved. If you remember the first phase or the mobilized phase, we spoke about the fact that, you know, we are going to talk about influencing just those three or four set of people, right? Which is the people whom you should ask for feedback, people with whom you should provide reports and updates, people who will become your change agents, who will go out and drive the scale into the organization, and the key stakeholders or the steering committee members. So right now, if you're at this stage, we are assuming you have understood what needs to change. You have figured out what kind of, what is the behavior shift that you need. You have a very clear idea of what should change to what, right? You have some buy-in or investors already invested in the success of your project and all of that. So you already are seeing some success from that point of view. You've sought feedback. Everyone gave you positive feedback around what you're trying to do. So you very clearly understand what needs to be done next. And you figured out what is moving, right? So now, how do we take that and scale it into the larger organization, right? So that's the phase that you typically move into right now. So this is the phase where you need to replicate yourself. So when I say replicate, what do I mean? Every one of those change agents, if you remember, the third box was the change agents that you will recruit. Hmm. So now each one of those change agents needs to be as good as you. So you need to replicate yourself in those change agents, which means that they know as much as you do. They understand the entire change process as much as you do. They understand what is at stake as much as you do. They understand what needs to be done. They understand who the key stakeholders are. They understand what are the next steps. So it's as good as they know everything that you know. In addition to that, they also understand the context in which they will be driving the change, right? Because you cannot be there everywhere. So what you are trying to do here is you are trying to replicate yourself and your ability and your thought process into the organization. If you understand, just a very simple analogy, okay? So which is imagine yourself as an amoeba. So what does an amoeba do? Right, it's a single cell structure, right? It kind of grows and divides itself into two. And again, each one of those grows, divides itself into two. Again, grows, divides itself. Grows, divides itself. It continuously spreads. Same way viruses spread, right? So that's exactly how these change agents need to start functioning within the organization. You need to replicate yourself, not duplicate. So there is a big difference between duplicate and replicate. Duplicate means they become a copy of you. Replicate means they inherit everything that you have in addition to what they already have. Does that make sense? They have their own context. They have their own experience. They have their own story. They have their own way of working. They have their own skills and expertise. In addition to that, they get all your expertise. This is where the leadership part of leading transformation comes into play. So typically, what do leaders do? One of the biggest roles of a leader is actually to create more leaders. And how do they do that? They do that by multiple things, right? So number one, they coach their people in terms of, you know, how do you think, in terms of how do you approach problem solving, in terms of how do you understand what is going on, in terms of how do you, you know, act in a given situation. So that is what is the biggest requirement in the entire scale process. If you don't get this right, everything else becomes a problem. Because going forward, it is not you who's going to drive the change. It is these people, these change agents, who will actually go into the organization and drive changes. So let me give an example. Let's say the transformation that you're trying to drive is implementation of a significantly large IT infrastructure or IT or a software solution. Now, these change agents are the functional guys who are part of your core team. Let's say someone from finance, someone from sales, someone from marketing, someone from IT, someone from operations, someone from manufacturing. So when they go back into the organization, into their respective functions, they become the point of contact for everyone in that function or organization to go to when it comes to anything around, any questions that they might have around this change, they become the go-to person. Right? So that is why they need to understand as much as you do about the change. That is why you need to be able to impart everything that you know, everything that you have thought through to them. Right? This is a very critical step. So if you have any questions, if you don't agree, if you have any, ask me now, because it's critical that you understand this. This is the leadership leading of the entire leading transformation that we are talking about. Right?
So can I go?
Go on, please. Just so, bring your hand to the camera so that I know. Yeah.
Okay. So what happens is most of the times when we get into such discussions with different functions, they, at the beginning, because of resistance to change, you know, the typical kind of conversation is, hey, but my organization is driven against a different goal, a different metric. You're asking me to do something else, and this change will impact my primary goal or metric. So I'm not going to, agree with you, or I'm not going to do it, or, you know, I don't want to, I want to do it differently or whatever. You know, so this is a very common, I think, you know, at least in my org, and this is a very, typically the first kind of discussion that I end up having.
Exactly. So that's, so the reason why you're having that discussion is because they were not involved right from the start. The reason you're having that discussion is because the KPIs are not aligned. Again, so KPI alignment is a much bigger topic as well. And that's a totally different conversation. I am assuming that because the leaders want this to happen, I'm assuming that at some level there is alignment between the leaders, and you will not end up facing this. If that happens, immediately what you need to do is actually go back to your steering committee, and get their alignment. And that is the reason why, if you understand, if you remember, the steering committee has a mix of those who get impacted, those who are leaders of those who get impacted, and those super connectors. So if you have done that steering committee selection well, if you have kept everyone involved updated, if you have sought the feedbacks from the right people and identified the right change agents, you will not have that conversation. You have that conversation because the earlier part of the work has not been done. Right? So as long as you have done that, more or less, you will not end up having that conversation. You will have a different kind of a conversation, which is that, you know, people might not be, these change agents may not be as confident as you are. So while you train them, while you show them how they need to think, while you actually, you know, enable them, while you give them all the required piece of content, required piece of mindset training, they may not be as confident as you are. So they may not be in a position to go out and stand in front of their, let's say, their HOD and you know, respond to the queries that they might get there. That is a different kind of a problem that you'll end up facing. So that is where we'll come to what all they need to know, what all they need to learn, which after this, everything else is about what do they need to learn, what kind of skills they need to have, what kind of mindsets they need to develop in order for them to be your replica when they go back into their organizations and represent you and the change initiative and the transformation initiative. So that's the biggest thing that you will take away from today.
Got it. Yep.
Yes, Nitin.
Isn't it like a story? Like you're selling a story. This is your story. And then unless it becomes their story, they won't contribute. And the challenge would be if goals are not aligned. Let's say if these people have different goals, if they are not seeing their goals are aligned and they are buying into that story, always this problem would be.
True. So we'll come to that. I think storytelling is a big part of scaling. So we will touch upon that just in a minute. Anyone else? Any thoughts, comments? Priya, I'm assuming that you can hear us. So if you can, just drop a note.
Okay, now even I can speak, finally. Since morning, I'm on Zoom meetings and suddenly my hotspot data that gave up. So yeah, no, I'm on my phone now, on one device.
Okay, cool. So we'll come to you at the end of the session to figure out what you'll do this session at the end. I hope that's okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, perfect.
Okay, cool. So very, very critical, replicate and not duplicate, right? So that's a big part of what scale is all about. Now, let's go to the next one, which is creating a network of change agents, right? So if you remember the analogy that I shared in terms of, you know, viruses spreading or amoeba kind of spreading. So this is how change agent, network of change agents functions. You are the central node, or you know, you can be the central node which gets connected to every single one of these networks. So each one of these is part of your change agent network, the list of change agents that you have. So they in turn are part of a network, right? So for example, if you're talking about finance function, they are in the network of their finance functions. Now, one of the best things that can happen is if they can directly engage with each other as well. So that's the second level. So first level, most important is, can you create these pathways of connection wherein you can learn from each other? They know whom to reach out to in order for them to get the support that they need. So let's say, for example, if they're doing a presentation in front of in their organization or in their department, and they need material, right? In terms of, you know, what are some of the things that they need to prepare? What kind of questions they might get? How do you answer those questions? they know whom to reach out to, right? Now, this is the basic or the first step. Second step in creating a network of change agents is, can they talk to each other? You know, can you create a network where you don't necessarily become the bottleneck? Because right now, in this case, I become the bottleneck, right? The next step is, can these guys talk to each other and they come to you only when they don't find the answers among themselves, right? And at the same time, they're all connected to you. So that is the second level of creating a change network. And this is important because we need to understand that every one of these people are going and contributing back into the organization. This is where scale happens, right? From one, you reach out to five, and from five, you reached out to how many? How many? Can someone count?
25?
Yeah. So 5 to 25, right? And once you have these 25, you will find it becomes their job, the change agent's job, to identify. If you remember the six kinds of people that we spoke about in the first session, right from conspirators to co-creators. It becomes their job to find out who your co-creators are, who your collaborators are, who your whom they can recruit as the change agent. So they go ahead and they become spreading your change agents even further into the organization. And that is how you can scale change. That is how you can scale transformation. Typically, what happens in an organization when you're trying to drive transformation or trying to drive change, you have this one guy sitting here and talking to everyone, right? They don't have these networks whom they can go and talk. So the key part here is, since they are part of this network, they speak their language. They know what is important for these five people. They know what kind of terms they use. They know what kind of things are important or crucial for them, and how do you address those questions or queries, right? And that is why it is important that the section of change agents comes from, number one, those super collaborators, if you remember, influential collaborators and the influential leaders, right? So that's the second part of scaling change. Before all of this can happen, you need to craft your key ask. So until this point, one of the biggest things that you should have done is know what should they go and tell their teams. What is it that you are asking the larger organization to do? If it is a 5-point agenda or a 10-point agenda, you are already asking for too much. What is the base minimum that if they do, everything else follows?
V is equal to MAT.
Right? So that is the formula. So you need to find that base minimum behavior change that you expect. So if you actually look at this advertisement, it is in like 7 words, they are able to showcase something which it's so difficult to showcase, right? What does it say? More people are killed by cars than by guns worldwide. So that is the level of clarity you need to have in your ask. It has to be absolutely simple, so that when you go out in your organization, in the larger organization, and you say, if you remember also the first one that we spoke about, which is DVF greater than R, right? So this is the first F part of that DVF greater than R. So as long as you have this nailed, if you have not got this nailed, you should not scale. But once you have nailed this, you are ready for scale, right? Now,
Mukesh, I have a question.
Yes, Priya.
So in the previous slide, when we were recruiting our own change agents, right?
Yeah.
So how you built your team, how you identify the five members, basically those are actually the collaborators and not from any other category.
Priya, if you remember in the first session that we spoke about, we had this this Venn diagram, right? Yes. Of the people. So one is the people who are impacted.
Yeah.
On the other side was influential collaborators. Then there was influential leaders.
Yes.
And at the intersection of influential leaders and influential collaborators was the that intersection was called change agents.
Correct.
Agreed. It is those guys are these guys, change agents.
So I am trying to fit it into the six types of people, even influencer who are getting impacted or who are
they will be typical. Yeah, so they will typically fall into collaborators or co-creators.
Okay, right. Got it now.
Yeah. So once you have this message ready, once you have the ask ready, right? So the next thing that you need to do is create a living FAQ document. Yes, Rajesh.
So you said that unless this simple ask is not nailed down, it is not the time to scale yet. I'm just assuming that this key simple ask might be different from different functions or yes. organizations, right?
Yes.
So for each and every organization which gets impacted, we need to have that key ask ready for each of them.
Yes, that's okay. Right.
Yeah.
So you need to have a living FAQ document created. What do I mean by a living FAQ document is, every time your change agents go out and start engaging with their stakeholders or within their network, they will typically get some questions, right, which they respond. So all of those questions needs to get documented in a place so that you are learning. Even before they go out into their networks and start talking, between the change agent network and yourself, you need to create a set of documents which is very clear in terms of, you know, what is the ask, what kind of questions might come up, how are they supposed to respond, you know, where can they find more information, you know, and anything else that is relevant. And this FAQ document becomes the life and the lifeline that each one of these change agents will refer back to every time before they talk or engage with their respective network. And this document becomes your living, breathing document, which tells you where are those resistance which might crop up, which needs to be addressed. Where are those issues which you have not foreseen when you have nailed down the message are cropping up, and how do you address? Right. This will also tell you where are those conspirators probably be aware of. This will also tell you where are those guys, what are those things which you have not thought through? Because there will always be. What are those surprises? What are those questions which your change agents are not able to respond? So that when they come back to you, you are able to help them. They know exactly what are those questions and how do you teach and train them. And that's the other thing that you need to understand is that these set of change agents and you need to meet on a regular basis. At times, depending upon the change and the pace at which you are trying to drive the change, it might be every day. It could be once in 2 days. It could be once in a week. It could be once in 10 days, depending upon the scale of change and the speed of change. But the key thing is that you meet regularly. You ask them what is going on, what are the kind of resistance that they are facing, what are some of the questions that they are facing. And based on that, create this living, breathing document. So you learn. So for example, there was a question that the sales department had asked, which the finance has not yet asked, but could potentially ask. So once you have learned that this question arises here, you automatically update the FAQ document so that the finance guys, when they actually, the change agent in the finance department, when they look at the document, they already know how to answer or respond to that particular question. Right? So that's the importance of having a living, breathing FAQ document. So Now comes storytelling, right? So each one of these change agents needs to create, come up with a story of their own, right? So stories change people, absolutely. And how do you help them come up with a story of their own, which they can use as and when needed in the change process? Now, it could be about the change process itself. It could be about how when they changed, it helped them. It could be about how changing them or how their past was with respect to how their future is. If you remember when we said you need to create that a contrast, right? With respect to what the past was, with respect to and what the future is going to be. In the first session, we spoke about that. So dissatisfaction, how do you create that dissatisfaction? So that dissatisfaction needs to come out as a story and it needs to be personal, which means each one of these change agents needs to craft a story of their own, which they can use when, as and when needed. Now, there are certain principles of stories which we can look at. There are many, many ways to look at it. There is one which is called A Hero's Journey. There is a book called by the same name by an author called Joseph Campbell. The book is called A Hero with 1,000 Faces, in which he talks about a hero's journey. And he claims in the book, and I've seen this work out in almost every movie that I can think of, in almost every novel that I can think of. There is a 12-step process which every story takes. There is a call to action, and there is a someone who supports him. Then there is the hero finds disillusionment. Then he fails. Then he finds some strength. Then he comes up, goes ahead and accomplishes whatever he wants to accomplish. So any and all hero-based movies or hero-based stories follow the same arc. You can Google A Hero's Journey, Joseph Campbell, and you will get those 12-step process. You can do that. Or very simply, you can craft a story by using this happened, IFTT, T is what I call it. If this, then that, right? So that is the most simplest way to craft your story. I had this problem, I did this, then this happened, right? So that's the most basic story structure. Now you can, then once you have that nailed down, then you can actually use some of these principles, right? Number one, stories have to be short and simple. You cannot have a story for which goes on for 3 minutes or 5 minutes or 10 minutes. A story should be at most 2 minutes to 3 minutes. That's it. Story, no preamble, no once upon a time I was there, this. You come straight to the story. Straight to the point, tell your story. It has to be personal, which means can you involve certain elements of your experience? Can you make it your own? In your own words, in your own, based on your own experience. Because then what happens is, if it is based on your own words, and if it is based on your personal experience, then it becomes that much more easier to tell the story. If I tell you, tell the story of, if I give you a specific story and tell you that, you tell this story every time, there is a little bit of a resistance because then that becomes a staged storytelling. Right? Because it is not your story, it is somebody else's story. And you're always looking for words. Right? If it is personal, it is always your personal story. So you can, it doesn't matter which words you use, it doesn't matter where you're telling, it doesn't matter. You don't need any preparation time. You can straight away land the story because it is your personal story. You need to know your aim. Aim stands for your audience, your impact that you want to create in the audience, and the message that you want to share or send to your audience. So as long as you cover all those three, your story is good. If you want to make it even better, can you tell a story in such a way that it raises curiosity in the listeners? So the I part of the aim is, can you create the impact so that people become more curious? They want more. Can you tell us a little bit more? Can you tell us a little bit more about this? How did it help you? How did it change you? Why did it help you? Why did it change you? Why did you do this? So as long as it raises that curiosity amongst listeners, your story has landed well, right? And last but not the least, it needs to be practiced. Irrespective of whether it is your personal story or whether it is somebody else's story, practice is what makes those stories better. This is like telling a joke. The more you practice telling a joke, the better you get at telling the joke, right? So this is what stand-up comedians do all the time. If you remember, if you actually look at their jokes, will not be more than 2 to 3 minutes at most, each joke. At most 2 minutes or 3 minutes. They will set up, they will create a setup, which is what if portion of the story. Then they will introduce a conflict, which is what this, if this, then they will resolve the conflict, then that. So that is exactly what a story is also about, right? You set the context, you create a conflict, you resolve the conflict. That's it. The more you practice, the better you get at it. And when you meet with your change agents, that is another thing that you need to do with them, to help them craft their stories and help them practice their stories. If you remember, if you actually go one level deeper, okay? So what you're going to do with your change agents is actually you're developing them as leaders. Because what do leaders do? They get people to act. They get people to act in ways which is good for the organization, right? Good leaders are great storytellers. So they know exactly what they want to achieve. They know exactly what impact they want to have, right? By just enabling your change agents to do all of this, you are actually making them, turning them into leaders, which is also part of your leadership team, leadership skills. Now, next one is also about influence. So if you remember, Rajesh, you said we spoke about influence. How do you influence others when you don't have the authority to order them, or authority in terms of formal authority? So there is a book by Robert Cialdini called Influence. And there is another follow-up book that he wrote, which is called Persuasion. So they are considered to be the gold standard when it comes to influencing anybody. So if you get the time, I strongly recommend that each one of you pick up that book and read the book, not once, but multiple times. Okay? Because that's like the best book that comes to influence without authority. Okay? He talks about 6 principles. And you'll find that, each one of these principles makes practical sense based on our experience as well. So the first principle that he talks about when it comes to influencing others is called reciprocity. Okay, he shares multiple stories, in a nutshell, if I have to explain what reciprocity means is, if I give you something, you would by nature want to give something back to me.
Hmm.
Right, that's human nature. So if I give you something, if I gift you something, you want to gift something back to me. Nobody wants to only receive and not give back. Even in social circumstances, right? So let's say, for example, you're visiting someone, you take a gift to them. Next time when they visit, they want to bring a gift back to you, right? Sure. That's naturally how we think. Same thing happens in work condition as well. This is the reason why a lot of times people say that, you should give before you ask anything in return. Always. So one of the things that I do at my work is whenever someone reaches out to me or whenever I connect with someone, my first question is, how can I help? The moment you are able to help others, by default, they are bound to help you back they will find reasons to help you back, right? So that's a very, very important principle to keep in mind. So second principle is scarcity. Can you create scarcity? Scarcity is how people respond, right? So if you go to a shopping center, this is exactly the principle that they use, just scarcity. Then comes authority. People want, if you go to a doctor's clinic, you will find that they have all these certificates hanging in their clinic before you enter the clinic, right? That is just to show that, you know, you are entering someone who is authorized to treat you. So when someone in authority says something, people tend to follow. So can you create, or is there a sense of authority that you can build in your engagements with your people? Consistency is another way of influencing. If you are consistent at something, people know that, you know, if you want that thing, he is the right person to go to. And if you are consistent, people can anticipate how you are going to respond to a particular given situation, right? So that's another rule. People like to do okay, so let me rephrase this. If you like someone, the chances are that you will do what they ask you to do, right? This is also one of the reasons why people say that, you know, be abrasive in your organization. This is why people play nice in organizations, right? And then nothing gets influence as much as social proof or consensus. So if you see 10 other people doing it, you end up doing the same thing as well. In fact, there have been studies in which professors put students in a class, in a group, and you know they flash questions, which obviously everyone else in the group, actors, give wrong answers. Evidently wrong answers. But one guy who's part of that group, who is not an actor, typically tends to go with the group, saying that, you know, if everyone else is saying this is the answer, then maybe I should go with the group rather than stand out and stick my neck out. There are certain personalities who might still stick their neck out, but generally you will not see that. So this phenomenon is also very visible when you are crossing the red light in a traffic signal. So if you're driving and you are the first person to hit the red light, and if you stop before the stop line, you will find that, you know, everyone else stop at exactly the same level. Generally, if you cross, everyone else crosses as well, because they see.
I thought that's applicable only in India. Sorry.
No, everywhere around the world. So that's consensus or social proof. So these are the six principles of influence. Seventh one, which he talks about in persuasion, is the environment that you are in, or the mental framing, as he calls it. So if you are put in a context which is geared towards making you behave in a certain way, then the chances are that you will behave in that way. So that's what the principles of influences are. Now, there is another book which is called Nudge. It's written by a guy called Richard Thaler. He won a Nobel Prize for this in economics, based on the work which resulted in Nudge. He talks about the fact that, you know, people do not necessarily do what is best for them. So you need them to be nudged in certain ways. Those nudges are called choice architecture. If you are interested in how this entire thing works, I highly recommend reading that book, because that's something that is one level above or the next level to these six principles of influence that we are talking about. A very interesting book and very fast book as well to read. Book is called Nudge. So first, we need to understand all of this. so that we understand what are the principles of influence. Once we understand this, we need to teach our change agents the same principles of influence and the principles of storytelling, so that when they go out in the world, in their field, in their organizations, in their network, they're able to exhibit or use these principles of influence in their networks in order to be able to get people to work with them, right? So I'll stop here and check if you have any questions, comments, thoughts.
Okay. Just wanted to clarify on one thing, sorry.
Yes, Rajesh.
The reason for change, I think at least at an org level, impacting multiple functions is already kind of set. The context is set right at the initial phase itself. The storytelling phase the storytelling aspect in which comes in terms of scaling is kind of personalizing that initial or initiation reason for, you know, at a deeper level. Is that what the storytelling is all about?
It may be that way. It may not be that way as well. So the storytelling at this stage is all about, if you remember that simple message that you've crafted after having done the mobilized phase, right? The one that we spoke about here. I did that slide.
No, that's the key. Yeah, I remember that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. The key. So that message, that is what this is all about. The story has to be about that.
But my question is, I'm.
It may flow from there, Rajesh. Let's say, for example,
what is the reason for? What is the reason for converting that initial message into a personal story? That's the reason I'm trying to.
Yeah, because understand. Most of the people are not. They do not care about the reason why the top leaders want to change.
So how, what, or how they will get impacted with that initial? So kind of personalizing that goal, the organization level goal, to this particular team or function or whatever, right?
So if you have done your job well so far, what would have happened is that goal would no longer be visible. What will be visible is the key message, the slide where you saw the key, right? So that message would be aligned to the overall overarching goal, but may not necessarily be the same. If you understand what I say?
Yeah, I understand it, but it sounds a lot more riskier now, because this sounds something like the Chinese whispers, right? So the initial goal was something, and it gets transmitted into something else, but keeping the intent. So that.
The outcome, see, the leaders, the reason why they wanted to change, the real reason or the impact they create, that cannot change. That remains. How they wanted to change might have changed. So the leaders might have said that, you know, we do these three reorgs, we do this, 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 but that might not be how you are actually driving the change on the ground. Because you've taken inputs from the influential leaders, you've taken inputs from the influential collaborators, you've taken feedback from the people who got impacted. Based on all of that, the intent is still the same. Because that, if you don't do this, what will happen? So that intent remains. But the process or how you wanted to bring that intent alive might have changed. That is the reason why.
I get that. Mm-hmm.
That is the reason why I'm saying that, you know, at this point in time, the key message is what the story has to drive. Because that is the ask. That is what you want people to do. If they do it all, if they do it well, and if they do it as you ask them to do, it will result in that impact that the leaders originally wanted to create.
So will the steering committee still play a key role in terms of in terms of scaling at this level as well?
Their role becomes less and less important as things go. So the reason why you have that steering committee at the start is so that, you know, you are able to nail all of this down. The key message is nailed down. Everyone is aligned. Everyone agrees that, you know, yes, this is the message that we want to, this is the behavior change that we want to see in the organization. And therefore, once it is aligned, and therefore you go out and scale. Now, of course, you'll come back and report to the steering committee over a regular period of time, giving them report on, you know, how the change efforts are going, what are some of the resistance that you are facing, how are you trying to respond to it, if you need any budgets, if you need any resources. So all of that will continue to remain. But the importance of having that steering committee and the role that they play is more critical right up front rather than as the things proceed. They will again become important if you run into a headwind. Okay, so for example, I'll tell you one example where this happens. The reason why originally this change needed to be done is now changed. So which means that, you know, the entire thing that you've developed from there needs to change. Right? Because you live in an environment which can change.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah. That happens all the time in my org. I can totally relate to it.
Some organization acquired you. Now what do you do? Right? So those are things which are extraordinary circumstances which you need to understand and address as and when they come. But right now, for this discussion, I'm assuming that level of change is not happening. Right. So if that is not happening, then what you need to focus when it comes to storytelling is that key message. How do you land that key message in the larger ecosystem is how you drive the change in the larger ecosystem.
Got it. Yep.
Now, having said all of this, you need to remember that you can't change them all. Right? If you remember, I said there are six kinds of people. There will be some people whom you can change. Some people who will obstinately say, I will not change. You do whatever you want to. They are willing to resign and leave the organization, but to change. That's okay. They will change or leave once you are able to build a momentum in the larger scale. So when you build the momentum, you know, rising tide takes everyone up. When water is moving out, it takes everyone along, right? So once you learn how to use momentum, either people will fall in or will go out. So you don't need to change everyone. It's a very important thing that you need to understand. The moment you try hard to change everyone, is when you will find resistance increasing. The more you push, the more they will push back. And they will create doubters in people who have already converted to you. So don't expect everyone to change. Very, very important message. One of the things which is important is celebrating success. So you will find driving this entire thing in terms of scale, you will find pockets of success already emerging. So you need to celebrate every success that you can see and celebrate. If you, I do not know how many of you had the chance to watch the video that I shared of my session for my book club on tiny habits. BJ Fogg, again, the same guy who created the B is equal to MAT model. He says, habits are formed by strong emotions. So if you actually read his book called Tiny Habits, he says, after every time, if you really want a habit to get embedded or to become, if an action to become a habit, you always need to end it with a kind of a celebration. Right? There is a physiological reason why you do that as well. So the physiological reason is the more dopamine you get for something, the more you will come back and do the same thing. Right? The way it works in your body is also the way it works within the organization. The more people see something being celebrated, the more they want to do that. The culture of the organization is set by two things. One, who gets promoted and celebrated? Two, who gets fired for what? That is what determines the culture of the organization. That is what determines the behavior of everyone in the organization. So if you promote based on political alignment, you will get political alignment. If you fire for non-performance, you will get performance. Simple. Or fear of performance, one of those two. Right? So that is what happens in every organization. So it is very, very important that you celebrate every, you find pockets of success and celebrate them. And not just celebrate the success, but also make heroes out of the people who created those success. Very, very important step. Because the more heroes you create, the more people want to become those heroes. Right? This is exactly what I said earlier as well. So what gets promoted, you get more of. If you promote more people or you make heroes of people who are exhibiting the new behaviors that you want them to behave, you are creating social proof. You are creating momentum. So more people will want to be part of that community. More people will want to be celebrated as heroes. And that is how change and behavior change spreads in large scale organizations. That's all I had for today. So if there are any questions, comments, thoughts, I'm willing to take. It's exactly, I think, 2 minutes past the time that we had. So I'll just stop sharing my slides so that, So Priya, maybe we'll come to you first because you did not have the chance to speak earlier. If you want to share something you remember from the last session, or if you want to share something that you think you find interesting from today's session, please feel free.
Both are the amazing things, Mukesh. First of all, thank you so much. I love the formulas in the last session. How non-verbal behavior can be put into equations. That was the, I would say, takeaway for me. And in today's session, I would say it's a cascading effect. So once we kind of establish the equation for one person, or like how the behavior shall be, how to replicate it more, how to expand the network. That is very beautiful. The way you mentioned that, how to capture the change agents and how to establish a network, basically. And the last point, which we just finished, like whom you hire and whom you fire. That kind of relates to so many things in my mind, like why we like some culture if we like it, and why we don't like something, how these biases come into play, because the soft skills or the behavior that your company or your manager is promoting sometimes doesn't align with you, or sometimes it aligns so well.
Yeah, true. So anyone else has any questions, comments, thoughts? My physics professor, when I was in college, used to say this. After every lecture, he will ask, you know, any questions, and he will find that, you know, no one is asking any questions, because half the times we could not understand what was being spoke about. He used to teach us atomic and nuclear physics. So he would say, you know, there are only two reasons why someone is, class is not asking any question. Either you understood 100% of what I spoke, or you have understood nothing. So my experience tells me that, you know, there's always a third reason. People understand a little bit, but are reluctant to ask questions. So that is probably the most important, most valid reason why people don't ask questions or comments. So
for me, it was a heavy session. I'll be very frank, and there's a lot to grasp here. Because for me, it's not only about having a conversation and, you know, forgetting what we discussed here, but it's all about absorbing this and, you know, trying to implement this. And there are just so many things here. oh man, this is just too heavy for me. I'll take some time. I'm sorry.
Okay. Cool. Revisit the recordings once you get the same and see if you want to deep dive into certain aspects of the session today. So if I have to tell you three things that you should definitely take away from today's session, those three things will be the following. Number one, replication is most critical. You know, you need to be able to enable your change agents to be able to answer any and all questions that might come their way when they go out and talk and engage in their network. Okay. Number two, you should help them build their story that they can go out and share. And number three, it is all about in creating and maintaining that network of change agents. As long as you create that support network for your change agents, I think most of the times you will find that whatever resistance comes up, they're able to address it within and among themselves. Those are the three, if I have to tell, are the key takeaways that you need to remember. Everything else you can learn. I mean, by just giving you a list of six influence principles, I'm pretty sure you will not become influential out of the, tomorrow morning when you go to work. I'm sure you need to think about it. You need to remember them. You need to be intentional about, being influential, which means that, going with an attitude of reciprocity, which is, don't go in expecting someone to return. Only help people who can return in return do something for you. Do the more you help others without expecting anything in return, the more you will get in return. There is also the principle of gratitude and the principle of helping others before without expectation for help. Hindu mythology also tells this, right? So you help without anything in return, but you will get more in return. So same principle, but if you put it in practice, it pays dividends in heaps and bounds. I know this because in the last 10 years in my current role, I don't have any authority over anybody to ask them to do anything, whether it is my customers or whether it is my colleagues, but I still am able to get on a regular basis easily about 50 to 60 people doing presentations to customers, answering uncomfortable questions, which they need not answer at all because they need not have done those presentations at all, but end up doing those presentations simply because of the fact that, they've seen me help them out without anticipating anything in return. That one principle alone has helped me do my job really well in the last 10 years. Just that one principle of knowing reciprocity always works. So that can be another one that you can take. Whenever you go, help without anticipating anything in return. The more people you are able to help, the more you will find people are willing to help you. So any other questions? Otherwise, I think we are in time for today's sessions. I'll share the recordings once the same is available, maybe tomorrow morning or before you get up in India. And I'm looking forward to the last session, which is going to be about embed. We will again come back to BJ Fogg and his model of creating habits when it comes to embedding some of these changes that you've enabled in the organization if you've followed this process, and then end the session from there. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Stay safe and stay healthy. Take care.
Can I ask you a few questions?
Yes, Priya, please go ahead.
Yeah. Sorry, I couldn't switch on my video today, but I really wanted to know, how about the sessions in future? Do you conduct this very frequently, or how does it work?
So this is the first masterclass that I'm running. I intend to run the same leading transformation masterclass. The next time I'm planning to run it as a half a day workshop rather than do it over 4 weeks. And that's going to be somewhere, if I remember correctly, it's mid-June is when I have planned it. And I also plan to run sessions on leadership, on behavior change, on personal development from that perspective. So those are going to keep coming. So I will keep announcing them on my both on my LinkedIn as well as on my blog.
Okay.
So I'm also going to announce it to my email list. So that will be my next question to you next week, is can I keep you added in my email list so that you will get to know every time I post a blog or every time I announce a class. So there are five areas where I want to drive. I will be running classes on. One is around leading transformation, which is what I'm doing right now. So one is going to be around leadership itself. How do you become a better leader and how do you develop leaders? So that's going to be around leadership. The third one is going to be around personal transformation. It's going to be about, how do you lead a healthy, wealthy and wise life? So I have put together a few things which I strongly feel about. So that's going to be a personal transformation kind of a masterclass. The fourth one is going to be around creativity. How can we be creative? Because creativity is like a muscle. You cannot just suddenly turn out on one day and be creative. You need to be creative every day, day in, day out. So what can you do in your day-to-day life which will help you, number one, become more creative? And creative can be anything, right? It can be creative writing, it can be creative art, it could be creative ideation, it could be creative when it comes to leading, it could be creative when it comes to any aspect of your life. So that's the fourth class that I'm planning to run. And the fifth class that I'm planning to run is around parenting. I have a teenage boy, so I intend to share my experience of how do you parent teenage boys more specifically. So those are going to be the five classes that I intend to run.
Okay, so a little bit related to personal transformation, do you have mentors or do you do coaching as well?
Yes, I do. That's going to be, I'm going to start coaching on all five of them. It'll be paid coaching. And so that would be my next, that would be how I would have ended the next session, which is the last session. You preempted it. But so I intend to both mentor and coach. So mentorship is going to be a 4-week mentorship program. Coaching is going to be slightly longer. It's going to be a 12-week coaching program. Developing it in terms of, what does mentoring mean and what does coaching mean, and what you will get as part of mentorship and coaching. So all of that is right now under development. Hopefully by the next session, I will have more information about how each one of these are going to be offered. And if you want me to work with you, how will that work?
Okay, so that means you are launching it the first time, right?
I have done this with a couple of guys. There is one guy called Ravi, who's based in Bangalore. And there's one guy called Shiva, who's based again in Bangalore. Those were more on a per ad hoc basis. So whenever they had a specific issue, they would call me, and I would mentor them, and on a hourly kind of a fee. This program that I'm planning to run is going to be the reason why it's going to be 4 week and 12 week is because certain change programs or certain leadership programs or certain personal development activities take that much long to drive. And so that's something that I'm going to offer for the first time.
Okay. Yeah, sounds great. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, guys. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Okay, I will need one favor from all of you guys once we are done for next session, which is if you think I've added value and if you've learned something, I would like a testimonial from each one of you guys. But we'll do it at the end of next session.
Yeah, cool.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you so much. Take care. Bye.